Hello everyone, once again, let's get started with another chapter. From your book Hornbill, we are not afraid to die if we can all be together. Now let's see the character of the story. The characters of the story is narrator itself, Mary, narrator's wife, Jonathan, son of the narrator, Suzanne, daughter, and two crewmen, American Larry Vigil and Swiss Herbert Segler. Now, the introduction about the character. Narrator, he is a man of great courage, commitment, and conviction. Proved to be the best captain as well as best father with unending gift and determination. Now, next is Mary, a wife who always stood by her husband's side in all times of difficulty and considered her dreams as her own. Suzanne, she was a brave girl, her bravery, defiant, her father's resolve to fight the sea's strong storm to thin nail. Jonathan shows her bravery and his fearlessness in the face of death highlights his character. He rejuvenated the hope of his father by remarking, "We are not afraid to die if we can all be together." Now, and this is only the title of the story. Now let's go ahead with the introduction of the chapter. We are not afraid to die if we can all be together. Summary tells about extreme bravery and skill exhibited by Gordon Cook's family and crewmen in a war with water and the waves for existence. In the month of July, in the year 1976, the writer, his wife Mary, his son Jonathan, and his daughter Suzanne set sail from Plymouth in England to duplicate the round the world journey made 200 years ago by Captain James Cook. They took the trip in their professionally designed ship named the Wave Walker, accompanied by two sailors, Larry Vigil, who was an American, and her sailor, a Swiss, to tackle one of the world's coldest oceans, the Southern Indian Ocean. Now let's get started with the detailed summary. Now this is the incident which took place in July 1976. The narrator, who was around 37 years old and he was an old businessman, his wife Mary, along with 6-year-old son Jonathan and 7-year-old daughter Suzanne, they all set sail from Plymouth, England. They wished to go around the world on a long sea journey as Captain James Cook had done 200 years earlier. So it was their wish to go around the world. They started in 23-meter, 30-ton wooden-hulled boat named Whale Walker. The name of the boat was Whale Walker. The first part of the planned 3-year, 1,05,000-kilometer journey passed pleasantly. They sailed down the west coast of Africa to Cape Town. They took two crewmen, Larry Vigil, an American, and Herb Segler, a Swiss, to help them across the rough Southern Indian Ocean. On their second day out of Cape Town, they faced extreme strong winds. Now you can see in the picture also, which blew continuously for next few weeks. Waves rose up to 15 meters on December 25, the day of Christmas. They were 3,500 kilometers east of the Cape Town. Though the weather was very bad, they enjoyed Christmas and New Year's Day. The weather changed for the worse. On January 2nd, there were mighty waves, the huge waves. They were sailing at 8 knots. Dropping the small sail and fastened mooring rope in the loop across the hind part of the boat. Now at end of this PPT, I will show you the different parts of the boat also so that you can come across what which part they have lowered down or how they have saved themselves. Then they attached lifelines, put on waterproof cloths and life jackets and waited for the storm. Now they were aware that since the waves are very mighty, the waves are very huge, so they should be wearing all the lifelines, life jackets, put on the waterproof clothes so that they can be safe on the safer side. The first sign of the imminent disaster came as deafening silence. they were not at all aware that such a huge disaster is awaiting for them. The wind dropped and sky immediately grew dark. There came a growing roar and a huge wave. A tremendous explosion shocked the deck. The narrator's head stuck on the wheel and he flew over the side of the boat into the water. He was sinking below the waves. He accepted his coming death. He thought that now he is going to die. Suddenly his head appeared out of water. A few meters away, Wave Walker was about to turn over in the river, in the water. You can see in the picture also. Then the wave threw her upright. You can also imagine Titanic over here. Succeeding waves threw the narrator around the deck like a rag doll. The wave was so huge and so mighty. His left ribs cracked. Oh God. His mouth was filled with blood and broken teeth. He somehow found the wheel and lined up the stern for the next wave. There was water everywhere on the ship, but he could not leave his place in order to investigate the situation. Suddenly his wife Mary opened the door in the deck and shouted that they were sinking as the deck were broken. So there was a huge panic all over the ship. The narrator asked her to take the wheel. Then he moved quickly to the door. Larry and her were pumping water out of the ship. Everyone was occupied doing their job best to make to come out of this disaster. The wooden beams are broken. The whole starboard side and bulged inwards. Cloths, crockery, charts, tins and toys moved around noisily. In water, he crackled into the children's cabin. Sue had got a big bump on her head. He had no time to attend her because he was aware that something has to be done, otherwise it will be too late. He found a hammer, screws and canvas and started repair work. He managed to stress canvas and secure waterproof hatch covers across the gaping holes. Most of the water was now being deflected over the side. Then the hand pump started to block up the debris. The electric pump had no short circuit. The electric pump had a short circuit because of that water level rose up dangerously. He found that the two spare hand pumps had been pulled away by the currents, along with four staysail, the jib, the dignes, and the main anchor. He searched another electric pump, connected it to an outpipe, and water was pumped out throughout the night. They got no replies from their mayday calls. Sue's head had swollen alarmingly. She might have got hit very badly. She had two enormous black eyes and a deep cut on her arm. The situation is so pathetic. On the morning of Jan 3, the pumps had reduced the amount of water on board. This was a little bit relieving situation for them. Each of them took off for 2 hours, turn by turn. They had survived for 15 hours since the wave hit the Wave Walker, but she was not strong enough to take them to Australia. He checked the charts. He calculated that there was two small islands a few hundred kilometers to east. He hoped to reach Lee Amsterdam, a French scientific base, on January 4. After 36 hours of continuous pumping, they reached the last 4 centimeters of water. Now they had to keep pace with the water still coming in. Mary found some cornered beef and cracked biscuits, which was lying there only. So they ate their first meal in almost 2 days. Their relief was short-lived. At 4 p.m., again those black clouds began building up. Within an hour, the wind was back to 40 knots. The sea was getting higher. Throughout the night, the weather was becoming worse and worse. By dawn, on January 5, the situation was extremely dangerous. The narrator went into the to comfort the children. John asked if they were going to die. Oh, so pitiful. The narrator tried to assure him that they could not make it. Then John said, "We aren't afraid of dying if we can all be together." Such a brave child he was. The narrator could find no words to respond. He determined to fight the sea. To protect the weak starboard sides, he decided to stop the ship with the undamaged port hull facing the oncoming waves. He used an improvised sea anchor for heavy nylon rope and 222-liter plastic barrel of paraffin. More water rushed in through the broken plants in the evening. On the morning of Jan 6, the wind became less severe. So this was a relieving sign for them. The narrator got a reading on the sextant. He made quick calculation. She came in and gave him a card she had made. She had drawn caricatures of Mary and the narrator. Caricatures of Mary and the narrator. He also had a message expressing love and thanks. At 2 p.m. after checking calculation, the narrator asked Larry to steer a course of 185 degrees. He could then expect to see an island at about 5 p.m. Then he went below, climbed on his bunk and dozed off. He woke up at 6 p.m. John entered and asked if he could embrace his daddy. She was right behind him. They called him the best daddy in the whole world and best captain. They informed him that they found the island. The narrator rushed on the deck. He saw the outline of the island of Amsterdam. That night they anchored offshore. The next morning all 28 inhabitants of the island cheered them and hid them ashore. After reaching the land, the narrator thought of Larry and Herbie. They had been cheerful under the dearest stress. Mary had stayed at the wheel for those crucial hours. Then he thought of a 7-year-old girl who did not want them to worry about her head injury, and of the 6-year-old boy who was not afraid to die. Such a brave family they were. And to sum up, we are not afraid to die if we can. Altogether, summary, we can say the collective power of unity and never failing confidence of the sailors made it possible for them to survive and come out from the jaws of death. So such a safe family and family it was, and it shows how collective power of unity and never failing confidence made them survive and come out from the jaws of death with such a bravery. And I have shown here the parts of the boat or the ship. You can go through and you can now come out that how they have what they have done to save themselves. And on the next slide, this is just a comic strip with a short summary written over here. You can go through and you can now imagine about the story. And I will also make a small video of this, but animated video, and I will be sharing with you soon. Read the summary once again, go through the chapter and try to understand it more deeply. Thank you and have a nice day.